Hi everyone, am I audible? Okay, cool. So today we are going to talk about trial design intelligence, and when we say trial, it is a clinical trial that we are talking about. I just want to understand how many of you have actually worked on any pharma and R&D kind of project, so that I can set the context in a better way. Anybody who has worked on pharma or any clinical trials? Or all right, so the way we have structured the presentation is, we want to give you a brief background of what are the challenges and what actually happens in a clinical trial, and why do we need such a solution at the first place, right? Jumping in, who we are. So ZS is one of the topmost consulting firms across the globe, and we specialize in providing data-driven or analytical-driven solutions to our clients, and we span across many industries, starting from pharma, insurance, or say entertainment, and many more. However, majority of our business is driven through our pharma clients. We are located at 25 plus of offices across the globe. To be exact, I think it is 26. We have recently opened our offices in Seattle, Washington, and Cambridge. We have around 6,000 plus professionals who have deep domain expertise across different industries that we work at. And we provide solutions starting from strategy to technology to the entire deployment phase. All right. Moving on, what do we do? So this is majorly in terms of what we do in terms of to our pharma clients, and how do we leverage AI in providing these solutions to our clients. So we span across four different verticals that are in general there in any pharma company. R&D, which works a lot in HEOR analysis, or a lot of biostatisticians works there in clinical trials, getting the drug approved. Commercial comes into place when the drug is approved. How do we launch it? Which physician should we go at? So most of the brand management, where the drug is launched, all the drug management happens in commercial. Then supply chain is more of inventory management of the drug, how to make sure that it reaches every pharmacy at time. And then IT and enterprise functions are majorly to cater the internal analytic teams of the company, or setting up the infrastructure for the pharma company. And I will give you examples how we help each of the four. Right? Now, talking about R&D prior to launch. So this is one of the problems that we had solved, where we use a novel machine learning technique to identify patients who are at risk of a asymptomatic disease. So when I say asymptomatic, and it is an asymptomatic liver disease, just will give you background of the disease, right? So if a patient is not showing any symptoms that he has a particular disease, so for example, if we say a patient has diabetes, so what he'll do, he'll have a test and say that, oh, blood glucose level is really low or really high, and that means he has diabetes. But for this kind of disease, to identify whether the disease is actually present or no, you have to do a liver biopsy. That means you have to undergo a surgery, have a sample of your liver cut, and then do some biopsy over it, and then we can say that, oh, this patient has that particular asymptomatic disease. Now, what are the challenges? Why do we want to do it? So the client wanted to launch a product in the market in this particular disease, and he wanted to recruit patients for their clinical trials. Now, for doing it for a clinical trial, because you don't have any symptoms, it is very difficult to identify which patients are going to get enrolled, or it becomes a very lengthy process. So they reached out to us and asked, can we have a data-driven, or can we identify some biomarkers from the data itself, which could help us refine or get the patients enrolled in a very faster way. So we helped the client identify certain biomarkers or certain tests which can actually indicate the presence of the disease. So that at random, one out of every 100 used to have the disease. Now, once we give that biomarker, it is like 50 out of the 100 are having the disease. So yeah, hit ratio increases, right? Second, we use a lot of NLP techniques to intelligently gather and visualize all the clinical trial data, right? And the clinical trial data is present in multiple forms and across multiple sources. And our focus today will be on this, so I'll talk about this in detail later. Moving on to commercial, we have used a lot of techniques such as deep collaborative filtering, where we wanted to personalize some of the marketing messages and touch points for physicians as well as for patients. Another interesting solution that we provided a client was we enabled hyper-local triggers to the clients or to the sales rep of the pharma company, because in general what happens is a pharma company has sales rep, he goes to a physician and says that, oh, our drug is efficacious, and he talks about the drug, right? Now, when is the right time to go and talk to that physician, right? So we were able to identify certain physicians who are likely to get a patient in the next 3 months. So from patient level data or real world data that we have, we analyzed it and went through the patient's journey entirely, and we were able to figure out that, oh, this patient is likely to have a particular disease in the next 3 months that the client is interested in. Now we can easily look at which physician is the patient going to, and now we can go and talk to the physician saying that, oh, you are probably going to have this kind of patient and this is our drug. So it is like hitting the physician at the right time, right? And with the right message, because we can also identify what is driving a particular patient towards, or why are we saying that this patient is likely to get the disease, right? So identify the factors, identify the physician, and we can go to that physician at the right time. In the supply chain, we use machine learning techniques to forecast the SKUs that are daily SKUs and optimize the inventory so that the client can optimize the inventory. Now moving to IT, enterprise and functions, we use a lot of NLP and machine learning techniques to standardize the data, because there are a lot of people who are across the firm who are using, I give an example of real world data, right? There are multiple formats of real world data. To combine it and to have a standardized format is helpful for everyone who is actually working on that data set. So we use a lot of machine learning techniques to standardize and automate this kind of standardization. I'll take a break. Any questions as of now? So how many, when you have inventory, so we have some SKU units, as in how many units do we need to have in inventory at a particular time so that we are not facing any challenges in providing it to the pharmacies. Yes. Mm-hmm. So it is more of how much revenue you earn, because if you're targeting a physician, right? If you go there, and I think false the precision. So the metrics that we look at while we evaluating how good our model is, we look at what is our precision at, and probably we need to compromise on how many physicians we can reach out to, and we can reach out to only those physicians where we are really confident. So probably if we say our precision is say 40%. Right, so almost every 100 patients that we identify, only 40 are correct. But out of them, can we identify some cohort of patients where we are 100, where we are like 80% sure? And the risk of not reaching out is higher than not going out, right? So it is not something where we are losing out a lot. It is just we are saying that the physician needs to get detailed, or needs some sales rep needs to go to the physician to just detail that physician at the right time. So anyways, he was going to do that, but this is the appropriate time for him to go. So in general, if I say of a lifestyle of a drug, right? So if a patient starts a particular product, and generally we do it in US market, not for India currently. So a cost of a product for a company is around, say, $150K in certain disease areas. Certain disease areas, the cost of one prescription, that is 30 days of prescription, is around $200-$300K. So if you miss out on a patient, you lose out more rather than gaining, right? So it is always better to reach out to somebody. Currently, the chances of reaching out to a physician was at random, say 2%, because only 2% of the patients have a disease. With our model, they are able to be 40% more precise. So it is always a gain.
So,
Sorry, no.
So, when you say you're utilizing NLP techniques to intelligently gather data, what do you mean by that? Can you give me something specific?
Yes, so we are going to focus on this entirely for this session. I think this is the main topic that you want to cover. So we'll cover this in detail.
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Regarding the forecasting and inventory. Mm-hmm. So what tools are you using and what type of data goes into it?
So for SQs, I have personally not worked on it, so I don't have a lot of answers on that. I can majorly answer something here. Okay. If you have any questions. Sir. Yes. Correct.
The cost of missing out on that percentage. I mean, what volume of data do you look at when it is, let's say, only 1% of the population that is suffering?
So, this disease being asymptomatic, there are lot of, so actual prevalence, if we go to actual prevalence of that disease, it is around 10-15%. Right, but given that it is asymptomatic, only 2% of the patients are actually diagnosed with that condition. So there are a lot of patients who are actually having the disease, but nobody is identifying them. So, and the probably looking at what is the cost, right? So we'll go through the cost that is incurred in a clinical trial, then you'll understand what is the benefit of actually identifying such kind of patients.
Okay, thanks.
Cool. All right, I'll move to the next one. Okay, so here we start around, I'll just give a premise on what are the steps that are involved in a clinical trial and why do we want to go about this route or why do we want to have these kind of solutions, right? Any guesses on how many stages are there in a clinical trial? Any guess? 2, 4, 5, sorry? 5, not 20, but yeah. 7, maybe 7, but in general there are, it varies. So it depends on how many clinical trial or how many phases of a trial you want to have. So it varies from 5 to 7, right? So if I want to talk about which phases are there. So one is a basic science where we want to identify which type of drug would actually work for the disease or which type of molecule before even developing that drug. Oh, I think this kind of molecule can work on this type of cancer. So you hypothesize a lot in terms of what could work, what could not work. Once you have identified it, it is like a preclinical development where you want to test it on animals before even testing on humans. So that is the preclinical development phase where you develop the drug and test it on animals and see majorly how efficacious it may be or probably the safety profile or potential side effects of it, right? Now once you have passed this, that okay, it is safe, now we can try it on humans, right? So first it is being targeted on a very limited set of healthy individuals to see whether or what dosage is suitable for a particular patient, right? So it just tests. So it generally is called as a dose escalation study where you want to check what is the optimal dosage that you want to give, right? And it is majorly done to identify the PK and PD profile. So it is like a pharmacokinetics profile, which says at what levels of dosage works for a particular patient or in general humans. The next stage is phase 2, where we have identified now that it is working well. The dose is, this is the general, the dosage that you want to have. Now we want to give it to a target population, which is like patients who have that disease. And this is done on a very limited set of patients because we don't want to try it out on a large chunk of patients here. So this is, once we have identified that dosage, this is the range, but we don't know what is the exact dosage that works for the disease. We just know that this is the maximum minimum dosage that is allowable for this drug. Now, once we go in the phase 2, we look at a very small set of population and it is majorly done to see how efficacious it is and what type of dosing is actually suitable for that, for the patients who have that disease, right? Now, moving to phase 3, once we have successfully said that it works, it is actually helping, we move into phase 3 of a clinical trial. And here it is done on a bigger population, say 100 to 10,000 patients. For some diseases, it is even difficult to get 100 patients for very rare diseases. I think that is one of the challenges that currently pharma industry is currently facing. And once you have done a phase 3, you go to a launch, right? You submit to FDA for approval, with all the regulatory studies done. What I'll do is, there is also cost involved and how much time it takes to go through each of these phases. I'll give a hint of, so the first basic science, it is variable. Somebody has already looked at it. Some places, if it is a very new area, it takes a lot of time. So it generally spans from 1 year to say 10 years for just identifying what is the target drug or target molecule that I want to look at, right? Any guesses for preclinical development and how much time it takes, which is cycle time, and how much, what is the cost involved? And third is, what is the probability of success? Any guesses on how much time it takes for preclinical development? 10 years, okay. 6 months, okay. Any other guesses? 2 years. And cost? Sorry? It is average, in general, average. Because, and definitely it varies in across the drug, across the therapy area. Probably oncology, it takes more. But on an average, if I want to scale it, how much cost do you think is associated with just the preclinical phase? Any random guess is fine. 1 crore. Probably can, that is 10 million. I'll put in dollars because, okay. $10 million, it's okay. Any other guess? Sorry? 1 million, okay. You are very optimistic, huh? So it takes around 5 to 6 years in the preclinical development phase, and the cost associated is around $800 million, which is close to 1 billion, right? And the probability of success ranges. So on an average, I can say 70% of chance that you spend $824 million and you succeed, right? Now, moving on to phase one. Now you have tested it on animals. Any guesses on how much time does it take in phase one? Seven years. Now you have tested one. There should be some leniency. Okay. Huh? 1 year. Okay. Any other? And how much cost? Sorry? 100 million. Okay. So cycle time is around 1.5 years for phase one of a trial. Cost is double of, or almost close to $300 million. And the chance of success is 54%. So it has reduced from 70 to 50. Correct. But then the trials fails because of a lot of reasons. We can talk about what are the reasons, and this is where the application actually plays a role on how we can help increase the success as well, both, right? For phase two, I'll just bring it out. So it takes around 2.5 years to complete phase two, because you want to look at, so phase one was just to identify whether or what dosage level works for humans in general. Here you're doing a target population where patients who have that disease, and see whether the drug is actually working or no, and what dosage level work. So the chances of success goes down, which is 34%. And then the cost of launch or cost of conducting that entire phase two is around, again, 300 million. So for phase three, it takes around, again, 2.5 years. The cost is again 300 million. But the chances of success increases because you've already tested on a smaller population, right? Now to submission, once you submit, it again takes 1.5 years. Some 50 million cost is associated with it. So this is like submitting to the FDA. And then post the success is because you have tested it across, the chances are higher, 90%. So in general, if I look at it, it takes around 10 years to develop a drug, around $2 billion investment to even come up or even start selling the drug. So there is a huge cost which is incurred before even selling the product or selling the drug, right? Okay, so now any guesses on how much do pharma companies spend on these trials? Say in the last 1 year, how much amount overall in any pharma company would have spent on these trials? So one trial, takes 2 billions, how much do you think? And for one drug? Correct.
Pharma companies pay them to, because it's like it can lead to any problems to their health, right? You are trying a new drug to them.
Correct. So I can tell you about how it happens. So in India, I'm not sure how the process happens, and in general it is difficult, right, to get people. And this is one of the challenges that people face, because it is not just, even though the patient is interested in recruiting himself or enrolling himself in a trial, there are so many things that the patient has to go through. So he says that, okay, I am interested, but there are too many things for me to look at, right? So there are multiple reasons. One is you're already very critical and there is no therapy or no drug that you that is actually curing you. This is a place where people say that, okay, I want to enroll in trial. Hopefully it works. So in this way, and the companies actually pay for them. And then they are getting free medications, getting all the facilities free of cost. So they are okay in enrolling in such a trial.
I had one question. Like, you provided these figures, right?
Mm-hmm.
Also, is it like just an average based?
Yeah, it is an average value.
Right, because it depends on profitability of a particular drug they are targeting and on the amount they want to spend. How much is this consistent across different type of drugs they want to develop for different type of diseases?
Okay, so I'm not sure about when you say profitability, right? Because how much a client is willing or a pharma company is willing to spend, I think that is a question. Because when you say I'm launching a new therapy in a area where no other drug exists, their company is ready to spend a lot of money there. However, if I want to say that, oh, I'm launching a drug which is in diabetes market, but it does not cure diabetes, it is very similar or just 10% more efficacious than some other medication. In this situation, the cost will be lower and the company would be more looking at, oh, whether it is even beneficial to go through that phase or not. So that it is the preclinical development phase. That is where basic science, where you decide whether I really want to go or not go. So that is a decision made in the first phase. Once you decide that, oh, I want to launch a particular drug in this therapy area, then probably you have to take all the calls that you mentioned about profitability or any other thing.
Okay, so there could be trials which could cost way too less also, or way
too
more also.
So this is an average number that, as I mentioned, a clinical trial which is in a very niche area where you're not able to even recruit patients, it costs very high because the cost of recruiting itself is too high.
So there must be some back propagating also involved between the phases. Yes. As in when the clinical trial fails, they must go back to the basic design stage.
Yes.
And tweak some of the features of the molecule. So the cost and the timeline that you mentioned involved those situations as well.
So once you know that this is the molecule, you won't go back again, right? Or that is another set of clinical trials that you have to conduct. So if a trial fails at say phase 2 because of some reason, either company says that, oh, there are some reasons why it failed, right? Because you have to submit your results to FDA and say that, oh, these are the results, and they say that whether it failed or no. So there are certain criteria which are predefined on which suggest whether this trial will go on or not go on. Right. If you say that, oh, just there is a tweak that I need to make in a molecule, probably you have incurred a huge loss from the beginning.
Like, and that's why it's kind of done in phases. So when you do the basic science, you kind of know what all things you are testing. So it's highly scientific. The probability of failure is not something, you know, that happens very easily. So although the reason why the POT you see is less is because of the operational issues, like sometimes you're not able to recruit the kind of patients. So that you cannot plan for. But that doesn't mean that your preclinical development phase was wrong. So like that back propagation cannot not be attributed just to the molecule development. There are some operational risks that are there during trial.
Okay. So we are at how much cost in general, right? If I want to talk about it, total global pharma spending on R&D, right? In say 2020 we are current, so it is forecasted to be around $170 billion. So this is the overall spend that pharma companies do on R&D. So that just want to suggest that there is a huge amount of money that is actually getting spent for getting this drug approved. Now, if you want to see, if this much money is spent, pharma companies would want to see their product getting launched, right? So if you look at this, number of approved drugs per $1 billion spent on R&D, what we see is it is exponentially declining. So that means as we are going, and probably in 2025, we would be reaching a stage where the manufacturing or going about it, doing a trial for a drug is actually negative. So you'll be at loss of 4 to 5%. So which is not a very good news for us, because pharma companies will give their hands up and saying that, oh, this is not profitable. I'll probably not do any kind of R&D, right? So what do we need, right? This is more of how much cost per drug is involved, right? So, sorry. Yes, yes, we have. So in general, what we've seen is, in general, a clinical trial, the rate at which it is growing is around 7%. And currently we are looking at US market, where the inflation is around 2 to 3% as of now. So we have taken into consideration on how much it takes. Right. All right. So now quickly moving to stages so that we can cover the main topic of discussion. So this is just to say, because we now looked at what are the different stages in a clinical trial. Now once the clinical trial is in the development phase, where we want to do a phase one trial, where we want to test it on individuals, these are the stages that are present, or these are the steps that any clinical trial phase follows, right? So the first is you need to design the study, it includes what type of analysis do I want to do. Do I want to compare the drug with the placebo, or do I want to compare it with a competitor drug? So we want to do a design study. Second, once I know about it, I want to design a protocol. So what do you mean by protocol is, it is a set of rules, right? What kind of patients do I want to recruit? A patient, so for example, I want to do a clinical trial phase one study for a drug which is going to get launched in a cardiovascular disease. So there are a set of rules. Patients should have a hypertension, patients should have hypertension, they should have diabetes, they should have a particular lab test which is greater than X, right? Which the value should be greater than X or Y, or the ECG should not be normal. And some of the criteria is like excluding patients. Even though he has this, the patient should not be less than 18 years of age. He should not have other three kind of diseases which are very common to these kind of patients. Some of these criteria come into design protocol, right? Next is, once we have designed it, we need to submit it to a regulatory authority. They'll approve and they say that, okay, this design seems good, you can go ahead. Now, once the design protocol is set, the second challenge that comes in is, oh, I have designed the study, which physicians do I want to recruit for conducting this trial? Because you have a lot of places where the trial will go on, which physician should I involve? Because he's going to, in the end, talk to the patients, see the results and analyze them, right? Now, once you have identified investigators, then there is an ethics committee which will say, oh, these are good. And once after the ethics committee review, you finalize that these are the set of investigators that are involved. Now, once you have identified the physicians, you also want to identify, where do I want to conduct these trials, right? So it is site initiation. Now you want to see which site, because a clinical trial is not just conducted at one place, it is conducted across countries so that you get a variety of patients, so that your drug is not biased towards a particular set of patients. And in one country itself, you'll have multiple locations, right? Now, once you have this, you have initiated. You have the design, you have the physicians who want to take it, you have the sites where you want to conduct those trials. Now, you start monitoring the site. In site monitoring, probably follow-up visits, where patient comes to the site, whatever tests he has to undergo, takes the drug, the things that are required, whether the drug is working or not working, everything is checked. Then comes, so all of this is managed through a data warehouse, where all of the details of that particular patients are collected, analyzed. Then a thorough statistical review happens, whether what was the difference. So probably if I want to say, are the people surviving or so there are multiple endpoints. So you want to see how long did the patient survive. So for example, a cancer product I'm talking about. Once he is in stage four, the in general the endpoints are what is the survival rate and for how long. So in general, survival rate is like 20%, but it is in general the placebo where there was a placebo drug was given, it they used to survive for 6 months. With this, they are surviving for 2 years. So these are some of the endpoints that are decided in the study design itself, right? Now the next part is final report and then submitting it to a FDA to get the market approval, right? So now you just looked at it. For conducting one phase of trial, there are these many steps involved, and there are a lot of opportunities that, or there are a lot of places where we can actually come up with intelligent solutions to help pharma companies in optimizing their trial, right? So for our purpose of workshop, we are focusing on study design and study protocol, design protocol, where we talk about how we can use some of the NLP techniques to understand or to improve or optimize their clinical trial or clinical trial design, right? So before we start a trial, right, so there has to be some prior research that should happen, that I want to look at a set of previous trials that have conducted, what are the research papers that have been published, so that I understand what is currently happening and what all things I need to consider while designing a study, right? So there is a lot of data which is available for me to analyze, right? So if you want to look at what is the prior knowledge. So if you look at how many publications, say in a particular therapy area, we saw that around 1.2 million papers are just published. And if you see how many randomized controlled trials are happening in the last 1 year, it is like almost 30,000 trials. So the type of information that you want to look at is like 30,000 trials. Probably for my therapy area, it may be 3,000 trials and say 500,000 publications that I want to look at. So you have to go through a lot of material that is available to design a study efficiently, right? So this is where we want to, and what are the current challenges that we face, right? So current challenges are scanning through multiple databases to get a relevant information and generating multiple hypotheses. Or this, because you will find a lot of contradictory information as well in a lot of publications as well. So we need to see what kind of hypothesis makes sense for my trial, right? So these are the challenges. And now we come to the premise in terms of why do we want to have. So background research to understand the know-how of the clinical experience, it is time consuming and it is a tedious process. Now the objective for us is how we can save resources and save time, right? And then avoid missing or misrepresenting some of the critical information, right? This is where our clinical or the trial design intelligence comes into place, where we build scalable and comprehensive corpus of study information so that we can systematically look at the trial data, then derive industry trends and aid improved study design. So can we visualize or look at some of the things that are actually done previously and intelligently or scan through it quickly so that we are able to make a decision, right? And then optimize your decision. Once you know that, oh, this is what has happened, I've analyzed it, now I know what to do, right? Then I'll optimize AI, then we can optimize the trial design in a better way. Okay. Any questions till now? Cool. I'll hand over the mic to Anshik. I think he can take you through the next phase.
So basically, what this workshop is focused about is how we can do that protocol designing and how we can use the NLP and some parts of ML to actually assist in making that decision better, of doing that systematic literature review, getting through thousands of papers, right? So there are like a bunch of modules that we did as a part of DI. I will be focusing on main three, which is around the linking the NCTs and PubMeds. So NCT is nothing but where a trial information is published, and PubMed is a location where the articles or the full report of that trial is published. Now, these two are independent data sources. So we have to intelligently think about how can we link them so that our information is complete. And the next thing that we'll be discussing about is the classifying patient segments. One of the very important, I would say, decision-making point is, what's the patient segment that I'm looking at? Now, this information is sometimes readily available as a part of information that is published, but many a times it is not available. So how can we classify a patient segment given trial data? And the third one that I'll be looking at is, how can we identify biomarkers and its corresponding value? Now, what are these biomarkers? These biomarkers are some chemical, like they are some cells, molecules in your body, which, you know, they have a change in behavior when you are facing a certain disease. So can we detect a particular value for these biomarkers and, say whether you are in stage one, stage two, or what stage of cancer you are or other disease areas? Okay, so just to set the premise for linking the clinical trials and published results in PubMed. So what happens is, all the trials that are done and US registered companies, they have their trials, the information for them published on clinicaltrials.gov. Now, the information is sometimes, it is very scattered. It does not contain the full information. So if you want the full information for the trial, like what were the results, what was the actual parameters that were taken to conduct that trial, then we have to see its corresponding article. Now, this kind of linking between the trial and article is not readily available, and we have to establish this linking. So the resource from where we can get these articles are present in PubMed, where basically we get for a particular trial the corresponding article, and from there we can get all the information, like, you know, what were the design parameters, what was the value that was used for a particular biomarker, things like these. Now, both the databases are NLP based, like they have the text data. You would hardly find information which is very structured, like in tables or images. So how do we link it? Now, we used a couple of features, like we can match the title of both the PubMed article and the trial, right? We can check their abstract. We can see there is a thing called as mesh terms, which are nothing but some tags which are pre-built given in the websites, which says that, okay, this talks about prostate cancer, or this talks about prostate specific antigen, which is nothing but a biomarker. So it gives those pre-built tags. And there are a couple of other data sources that we use, like, you know, title, abstract, the mesh terms, and what are the outcomes. Now, the way we link these sources is, one of the logical thing that would come to mind, you know, when linking these is, so there is a primary completion date of a trial, which is nothing but when the first endpoint, like when the primary endpoint results are achieved. So in the slide that Nikhil was talking about, there was different phases that were conducting, right? And each phase has an endpoint to be achieved. And that's when we call our trial to be successful. So when that primary endpoint is achieved, we are ready, we can publish a paper corresponding to that, right? So one of the logical steps that we can take is doing these kind of cuts. So we have these trial primary completion date. We say that any article that is published, after that primary completion date is a candidate for the right match for that trial, right? And the second one is, we talked about investigators. So investigators are the person who write these articles. So that author name matching on the PubMed article as well as on the trial information, the trial investigator, is another step that we take. So just to give you a brief idea, for prostate cancer, there are roughly 4,000 trials. And there are over 1.7 lakh PubMed articles. So if you just do the math, there are a lot of combination to achieve. But if we do these kind of filtering, which are just logical filters based on the author name identification, author name matching, and the filters on the date, we see that roughly for a single trial, like out of those 4,000, we get 10 to 15 possible articles that can be candidate for that trial, right? So we have reduced the search space to a lot. Then after doing those, where now we have reduced the noise in our system, right? So I'm taking you through the full journey so that you guys can tag along and ask more questions. So we have that, we have reduced the noise in our system from 4,000 into 1.7 lakh combinations to say 4,000 into 10 or 15 combinations on average, right? Now we now our task is how we can do this, matching between the content of the trial and the content of the PubMed article. So one thing that would come to mind is that we, you know, try to create some document embeddings out of that and, you know, do some cosine similarity. But the thing is that both these articles are not homogeneous. Like, both the data is not homogeneous. So when you draw an embedding on, say, trial, the kind of sentence formation structure that is there in our trial data is very different from a kind of sentence structure formation in PubMed data. So you cannot go about doing sentence embedding and doing a, you know, a vector space search and cosine embedding and saying that, okay, these two are similar. So our approach was more word-based, where we said, let us find out the important words that are occurring in each of these articles separately, and then try to match them. So the way we try to, after doing some pre-processing, the way we try to find the important words is using TF-IDF, where we said that we penalize those words which are frequently occurring in a document and also are occurring in multiple documents. So we penalize such words, right? And we were able to identify important words. Now, what are those important words? These important words are nothing but they are occurring in a document but not occurring in every document, right? You can think it in this way for those who are not very clear about how TF-IDF works. So we get these important words out of both the databases. And then based on different kind of text data like title, abstract, mesh, mesh terms, outcomes, right? We create a score, which is nothing but which points towards like what is the word capture that I'm getting if I just try to find out the important words on each of them and compare them. So we get a score out of it, and then we give a recommendation which says that, okay, for this trial, looks like, okay, this and this article is a candidate match. And, right, so now we are getting a coverage of 85% here, right? But if I give you a stats, generally this coverage is below, roughly in the ballpark figure of 20%, 20-25%. And it's a big problem to solve, because when you're doing a trial, you cannot just rely on CTGov results. You have to go to the article, you have to go through that process and, you know, find the tables, find those images and actually look at, okay, what was there. You have to do, it's a proper scientific process of, you know, designing a protocol. So you cannot just look at values that are just coming up in CTGov. You have to actually read the trial and do that. And that's why it becomes a very major problem. So you cannot go with 20% coverage. It means that only 20% of the times you have the full information. What you want to target is a better coverage. And by using this approach, we were able to achieve a coverage of roughly 85%. So this module also falls in the paradigm of how we can link databases. So like, for example, here we try to link clinical trials in PubMed. There are other projects that we have done at ZS which tries to, you know, harmonize different data sources. But like, this is one of those examples. Any questions?
You mentioned about that you are mapping the articles with the trials. So you mentioned one approach where you are checking the heading. How exactly you have achieved that?
Yeah. So the structure in which we get the data from CTGov and PubMed is in XML format, and we do XML parsing. And there's a header. There's a tag which calls it as a heading. So we distinctly identify what's a heading and what's an abstract.
But not necessary that all are in the structure.
Like, we see the coverage on already tagged data and things like these. Because for 300, 200 odd samples, you know, it's not enough samples to train, right? So I cannot put a text classification model saying, okay, this is the correct and one is the correct indicator for that, right? Yeah. So moving on to the, no more questions. So yeah, moving on to the next part, which is about how can we classify patient segments. And this is, I think, very good decision-making point for a person who is designing a protocol to actually understand what kind of patients are to be included, right? So, like, in our case, and again, I think it's a very big problem in pharma in general and many other use cases, is that we don't get annotated data set, right? And same was the case here, where for patient segments, we don't know, from looking at a trial, we don't know, okay, what's the patient segment of the trial, or we don't get this annotated data set very easily, right? So we kind of followed a weak supervised learning approach, where we said that we have some rules which says, okay, a particular patient is chemo naive, or, you know, it's or a particular patient is has metastasized or not. So there are some patient segments like these. And imagine that we have 400 odd training sample available with us, and now we want to learn our classification model on this, which says whether from this trial a patient is metastatic or non-metastatic. Let us just take this example, right? Now, how would we learn that? With just 400 examples and a lot of text right? We cannot actually say, you know, very confidently that, okay, this is a patient segment. So we followed a weak supervised learning approach where we were saying that, okay, we might have low samples as of now, but on the samples we are not confident, like on the samples which are not humanly annotated, let us include them in a cyclic manner. Now, what does that mean? I have these 400 samples. I take, say, maybe 300 samples from them and say train up any machine learning model I train on them. And then post that, I do predict on those 100 samples again. Now, it looks like that my accuracy is 86%. It means, and now if I want to include these 100 samples into my training data, or like new samples into my training data, now, it means that I am including with a confidence of 86%, roughly, right? So, our idea is that you keep including these, suboptimal samples into your model. And what you would see is that you would reach an inflection point kind of where you would say that, okay, adding new data sources which were not previously annotated, even though they are not like, we are not completely confident about their tagging, but adding them improves our model. And when you reach that inflection point, right, you know that, okay, you have now exhausted every possibility of learning more from the data, and you can call that as a classifier model. So a similar thing is happening here, but in a more convoluted manner, where we say that we have these data, there are certain set of label documents that we have, we do some featurization on them, and this part of pseudo document generator is something, as I say, that a rule-based approach. So imagine we have 1,000 samples, 400 of them are annotated, rest 600 is not annotated. But, and I take 300, good samples from those 400 units. And from the remaining 600, I take, 200 samples on a rule-based engine. I would just say if there is a mention of chemo in your title, then it's a chemo patient segment that we are taking, right? So things like these we do, and we create some pseudo documents based on keywords or based on, some rules. And then I basically expand my training data from, say, 400 now, 300 now to 500 or 600. And then I train it. So the model that I was referring to, any ML model, so we have used a neural net model where we are actually using some embeddings and, to go through the pipeline. If you want to use some boosting models like XGBoost or some tree-based models, the text iteration pipeline will change accordingly, right? So we did this kind of training. And then there was a cycle which says that, okay, I'm 86% confident about my predictions. Let me add these samples again and train again. Now the accuracy can go up or can go down. So if it goes up, you'd retrain it. And if it doesn't go up, then you resample and retrain it. So it's kind of that cycle that goes on. And the once you reach an inflection point, you realize that, okay, after certain iterations, I'm not able to, hire my accuracy, improve my accuracy. Then you stop, right? So there you said, okay, now I've learned from the data. Now let me use this as a model. So when we reached this inflection point, we were able to, very accurately identify these segments like metastatic, non-metastatic, hormone refractory, hormone sensitive, like, and there's other class like chemo naive and others. So these are just very pharma specific terms, but you can see it as class one versus class two. So if you were doing this classification, you were getting a F1 score of above 95% just with this approach. But imagine a case where we would have not used weak supervised learning. So there we were getting 77% as the F1. So we were able to see those jumps, and it's a very active research topic. Google and other tech firms have been investing a lot into this because presence of annotated data set is very sparse in text when it comes to text. So it's a big problem. I think if you guys want to research, you can look at libraries like Snorkel and things like these. So, any questions?
Do you need to do any debiasing with the annotation?
Correct. So, I would say they can be biased in two ways. One can be with the annotation, I think, and one can be in the model itself. So, like your model is only learning certain part of the data. So, both these problems can be addressed with model computation. So, instead of just training, say, one deep net or one model, what you can do is model competition, where you say you take a XGBoost model, you take a deep net model, you basically take models which learn things differently, right? And which has a different optimization metric. And then you say that, okay, on a unseen sample, you check what's the classification and what's the confidence of that classification. And each time you take the maximum one. You're getting a point? So in that way, the bias is removed. So even if you're learning the data in a similar way, that bias is removed by model computation.
If you have a bias in terms of, so let's say if you have more metastatic annotated
imbalance. So that
doesn't that get, does it get reinforced, or do you do some debiasing in one of the?
So that's more a model problem, I would say, rather than, so if you see the context of this, this is more presence of data problem for us, right? So if you do some tweaks in modeling, I think those imbalances can be handled. Okay. So again, I would say that that imbalance in case of, say, class imbalance, or that imbalance in case of where you are learning the same thing again and again, those all imbalances can be improved by model tweaking.
Yeah, so my question is around the accuracy values, which is mentioned here. So, I mean, what I understood is like out of the entire data which is available, very few documents are annotated, right? And then we are training on that, and we are trying to annotate the other data, which is not, which is kind of unseen as of now. But if we do it on a cyclical process, like we keep adding it. Now, when we added new data, and we are classifying it, obviously there would be some classification accuracy, as you mentioned, like maybe 70 or 80%. But over the period, I mean, how can we measure the accuracy? Because I mean, anyways, we have the unannotated data, right? I mean, so how can we confident on this accuracy?
So again, so I think to be confident on the, I think you're talking about validation accuracy, because in that sense, right?
No, I mean, when we are saying 87%, right?
So these accuracies now are on proper human annotated corpus.
Okay.
So so we have these human annotated corpus. Say we started with 400 samples, but we did not take all of them. We just took 300, 250 of them, and then incrementally trained our model. But that 150 or 100 samples is still kept aside for a final validation on our algorithm.
But how we are tagging the unannotated data? I mean,
So that unannotated data is predicted on. So once we have these 300 samples, when we do some, when we do some pseudo document generation, we train a model, and then that model predicts on this unseen data.
Okay.
Right.
Which is you kept aside.
Yeah, which is unseen, like which is not annotated.
Right. But that's where my question is on the accuracy of that.
Yeah, so that accuracy also comes from, like, you do a certain kind of validation steps, right? So you have taken the fine, in the first example, you have taken 400 actual data sets. So 250 plus 150, which are from pseudo documents, right?
Okay.
So those are the correct things. Now there you do a train test split, and you're training there, and you see your accuracy on 50%, on 50 samples. You see that, okay, it is coming out to be 86%, which means that when I predict on a new set of unseen data, that's also roughly 86%. If our model is training fine and it doesn't have, you know, things like overfitting and all, then the same confidence is carried in the unseen sample, right? Because the data is homogeneous, they are from the same cut. So that's the premise, that's the hypothesis that we are working on. If in the validation data you see, say, accuracy of 86%, then with the same confidence you can see that accuracy in your unseen data as well. And that you propagate back into your training data and then train again.
Okay.
What happens generally in this process is, and that's an indication, is when you reach an inflection point. So it can happen that each time you're adding unseen data, your accuracy is decreasing. This means that your model is not learning anything. You need to find a new model, right? But if you see an inflection point where it reaches a point and it does not improve, that means that you have hit the like bar, and means that, okay, you don't need to train further now.
Okay.
So,
thank you.
Yeah, so for, yeah, we have deployed it for one of our pharma clients. And it's also present as an internal offering.
So is it a continuous training process that you do, like?
Yes. So we stopped the training for this after some time as we reach the inflection point, but it's a kind of a continuous training process. Our stoppage metric is that when we reach inflection point, our model is not improving.
Could you just mention again what was the input data here?
Yeah, so this input data was again the text that we get from clinical trials data, like the titles, there is some objectives that are written, there are inclusion and exclusion criterias. So here the main data source for us was inclusion and exclusion criteria, because it clearly mentioned that I don't need patient from, say, less than 18 age group.
Okay.
So then it is also indicative of patient segment, right?
Okay.
So that inclusion exclusion criteria is the main text data here, and that is fed.
Okay.
And that is like, that is labeled again. So if we have these inclusion exclusion criteria, that is labeled against.
So
what kind of patients
are from these trials, from this trial data, we are trying to classify whether they belong to this set of...
A particular patient segment, correct.
Okay.
Correct. Yeah, I think the third and the last topic is around, you know, so...
So, I have a question. Sorry. So, what I understand from there that iteratively you are training it, your test set is very limited. So, you whatever accuracy you are getting on the test set, you're trying to replicate that by adding more data.
Correct.
So, what happens if that accuracy will never reproduce? So, what you got rid of your new samples?
In that case, we try to change the model. So, say suppose I was using a boosting model, right? But it looks like I also need to bootstrap it. Like, so I'll add those bootstrap elements to the model. So, I think if I want to answer that question, I would say that I'll change the model. Because here I'm taking deep nets. It can happen that deep nets may not work. Accuracy is dropping each time I add a, you know, suboptimal sample. So in that case, it seems like data is not learning actually anything. Even from the, see, even if you have low data, there is something that model learns, right? But if that, even if the model is not learning from that low data itself, then it looks like it's a model.
But then you must have a very enriched test set which cover all the cases. Otherwise, so, your test set cannot be exhaustive. That can say for sure that if I will roll out this model on production also, it will somewhat behave in the similar way. It will produce the same accuracy. So you are saying that your accuracy is 87% on your test set, but you cannot be so sure about it that out of those 400 samples, what are those 100 samples I have taken it so that I can... when I'm iterating this whole process, correct, I can replicate the same accuracy again.
So we did this exercise a couple of times, right? So we took different samples from that annotated data and we repeated it. And the sensitivity of the whole system was not varying. So it was quite stable in that sense. And that's why we deployed it. Like we said that, okay, this looks like that doesn't vary much with different samples. And it also then, you know, gives us the confidence that this particular data set is actually representative of the whole structure and it can be published. So one way that you can do is you can check the sensitivity of the whole system, taking different samples again and again, doing the repeating exercise and seeing whether your like F1 score changes. So for us, it was quite stable.
And you're resorting to some other models if your accuracy is not reproducing it?
Yeah, in that case, yes. Or maybe, so this is one way where we have not done model competition, like the modeling competition we have not done. But it can happen that if that sensitivity, so in our case, we were able to achieve that, right? Because if you look like noise for us was quite low. We knew that these information mentioned in inclusion and exclusion criteria, right? It is not like we are taking tweet data and trying to publish patient segment classifier. We know that information is present in inclusion and exclusion criteria. It's just that the text is quite huge in number. Like there are 200, 500 words. So in our case, that data did not contain that much noise. I think what you are coming from is that if the data contains noise, it is not that representative. How would you solve for it? So one way is to check the stability of the system. Another way could be that you try different models.
Hello. Yes. So how is it different from certain things doctors do? Like they also see symptoms and then they try to say, okay, this is a metastatic case or not, or versus a machine learning trying to do the same thing. Is it in that same direction?
Yeah. So the place that where this is coming on, this is already published data. So a doctor has not specifically labeled for us whether this patient is, like, in this trial, I did a metastatic, you know, comparison. I took metastatic patients. So the doctor, when publishing these reports, doesn't explicitly mention it.
No. My statement is, when we go to doctor and we show our test results, whatever test the patient goes through, they see those test results and then they can identify whether they are metastatic or all these characteristics, right? Now, are we saying that what doctor does, some machine learning model is also trying to do something similar?
Correct. It is similar. But I think the data that doctor sees might be a little bit more extensive. He can understand more tables than our model does. Our model works on text, but yeah, the connotation is similar. It looks at certain data and try to do an analysis with it.
All right. Thank you.
Correct. Okay. So I'll go to the last part, which is, so in text, you would say that if I give you a text today and I ask you to do something, you can read through it, you can give me a summary, but that is not actionable for me as such. So you cannot say that, okay, take this parameter and take another parameter and draw a line. Like I cannot see some trend from text data, right? So the general EDA that you see in text is word cloud or, you know, frequency count of certain words, right? But if you actually want to make that text data actionable, what you would do is you would try to structure that data. And that's where this idea comes from, where we say that you have a little bit of, you have these text data in your trial documents, in your articles, and you want to structure it. So for example, you would say that, and this is an actual excerpt from a trial article, that which says that like things like hormone sensitive prostate cancer as evident, and that the total testosterone level is greater than 150 ng right, per deciliter. Right now, for a designer who wants to design a protocol, he would also like to test the similar thing. He would say that let me test for testosterone level which are greater than 150 ng per dl, right? Because it has been done by other clients, other competitors like these. Now this information is present in the text. It's not actionable as such. I read through the text, I cannot write a summary saying again testosterone level greater than 150 ng per dl, right? Because then I have to do a search engine based search and see whether for this trial testosterone was searched or not. But imagine a case where I structure all this information and I have it in tables. Now this is my biomarker table, which says that okay, you have a testosterone, right? Testosterone was tested in this trial, and then there was a particular value that it was tested for. So having this kind of data available to you at hand while doing protocol designing is absolutely like it's very useful, right? So that's where this idea comes from, where we are trying to structure an unstructured text and unstructured data into some structured format so it becomes actionable, right? So the way we did it and how we did it is can be like broadly classified into two things. One is around we identify these entities, which is like biomarkers. So entities like testosterone or PSA, right? Now, since our domain is very limited and very scientific, like we cannot have many false positives here, the identification of biomarker is of prime importance. Like we cannot say we have a name entity recognition model which has just 80% F1 and we cannot deploy it, because you don't want to see things like, you know, reduction greater than 150 ng per dl. Maybe it says reduction as a proper biomarker entity, right? So to avoid those kind of situations, what we did was we used an external knowledge database, something kind of an ontology, you can understand. Like using that ontology, we were able to identify these biomarkers. And now the next task for us is, can we find the corresponding values for it, as it is mentioned. Like for example, for testosterone, it is mentioned to be 150. For PSA, it is mentioned to be like 50%, right? Things like these. And for like PSA, again, it is mentioned that it should be less than 10 ng per ml, right? So there are different things like these. So our main focus here is that can we identify these biomarkers correctly? And then can we identify the value corresponding to them? Now, the way we did these identifications was around, we use a knowledge database for identifying biomarker. And these value, you can, as it is, like, it's quite simple. Like, we do some regex-based operations, we do some pre-processing. We are able to identify these values, right? So sometimes you would find these values to be written as TWO2 rather than a numeric 2. So those kind of data normalization steps were done before applying regex, right? Now the task is, given all this data, right, how can we actually create these tables? And to actually answer that, I would say that we did some distance-based optimization, and what I classify as a distance is from these sentences, we can create some dependency trees, which basically shows that, okay, how this particular word is dependent on another word which is coming in the sentence, right? So we have these dependency trees, and we also have their actual presence. Like, for example, testosterone is nearer to 150 ng, like, testosterone is nearer to 150 ng per dl compared to 50%. Like, testosterone can also be mapped to 50%. Imagine that this is one inclusion criteria that is given, right? And testosterone can also get matched to 50%. So, again, so try to understand the system in terms of orderness of the system. Like, if the overall cost of the system is minimized, and we do an assignment in such a manner that, you know, testosterone gets mapped to 150, PSA gets mapped to 50, and then another PSA gets mapped to 10, the overall cost of the system is minimized, right? Because you are doing perfect assignments. So, and that's where this idea, like, you know, the genesis of this idea is, we say that we calculate these distances between the pairs, between the two entities that we have identified, and we try to, minimize this cost. And the way we do is, like, there's a simple linear optimization that we do, and which basically assigns one entity to another entity. And obviously, there are some constraints, like each entity that is identified should be marked, should find a relevant match, right? And for those of you like who wants to understand it more, it can also be seen in somewhat similar to a traveling salesman problem, where there's a salesman who has to reach different destinations, right? And how would you do the assignment such that overall cost is minimized for his travel? So it is similar to this. You can like get an idea from there, right? And so this is what we did. And then I think the next logical question would be how did we get these units? How did we get these attributes? And what is this type? So this type again is something that we already know. Like we are taking data from an inclusion criteria, so this type is like readily available for us. Other things like attribute and units are something I would call as gram regex. So we do some post-stack combination. So once we have identified, you know, a chunk which contains my information, like testosterone level greater than 150 ng per dl. So once I identify such a chunk, I do some post-stack based regex, and I'm able to identify units and attributes for it. So for a bunch of text, we asked our validators to create the similar kind of table. And if we go row-wise, we were able to capture 86% of the rows, like, right? So that's how we evaluated it, evaluate the system that we have built. Any questions? Yeah. Sorry? Correct. So why is that not coming? Yeah. Right. So the way this is constructed, so here you would see that the construct, like, you know, greater than, or where the entity is first identified, then followed by an attribute. So if our system was not following this structure, we generally ignored it, because we more want to find values where, you know, particular level was tested for a biomarker, because, you know, this is more an operational thing that we tested PSA 1 month later. But what we are more interested in is, okay, what was that knowledge that the designer first started with for another competitor? So he said that I want to test the testosterone as 150. Now these operational aspects, why we are not capturing it, is because these changes trial to trial. Now for my trial, I don't want to test it 1 month later. I want to test it 2 months later, 3 months later. But I still want to know what's the value that I'm testing at. Although this is important, but for the piece that we deployed for our client, it was not that crucial. So we basically ignored such kind of constructs that are there. So if you would see that these follows kind of a constructs, right? Because PSA, like the entity followed by an attribute and then followed by an attribute again, right? So that's the...
So you mentioned that you have created the dependency tree over here. Dependency tree, you have created a dependency tree over here. So you have write your own parser for that?
No, we use standard parsers.
So, but those parsers are trained on some other data. Your data contain many medical terms.
Correct.
Which are not present.
For the particular construct that we have, so if you see that, you know, things like, you know, level is greater than, and at the time of enrollment, these things are like, I think, quite normal is what we saw. So we didn't have any custom trained parser. We didn't use it because for our model, it was giving the right. But you're right that if you have a very, you know, parser which is constructed on scientific data, you can use Sciespace, your things like these. You can have those parsers as well. But we didn't find, you know, the delta to be that much. And you can get that parser, but the reliability of those parsers are still in question. Like, right, because there is a person who has open sourced his scientific parser, but then you cannot rely on it. Compare that to a Stanford parser, right? It's more reliable. So in terms of the methods that they are deploying, it's more reliable in that sense. So we tend to use that more traditional one. Yeah.
Hello. So basically, if in a sentence, if it's written like the testosterone level and PSA got increased by 50% and 60%
Correct.
Respectively, how do you identify that?
So in that case, you imagine, and that's where the primary cost optimization comes. So if you have the structure written, if you'll actually go and see the dependency tree for it, you would find that relation is in such a way that the first one gets mapped to the first one. So we did this kind of experiment. So we had a statement like AST, ALT is greater than 2 and 3. So we did this kind of experiment, and we found that for such kind of statements as well, where all the biomarkers are present at one side and all the numeric value at one side, and it looks to the naked eye that the cost is same, like AST can be assigned to 3 and ALT can be assigned to 2. But when we see the system, it is doing the fine assignments. And we also take the absolute distances. So ALT is more similar to 2, like the first value, and the other one is similar to the next value. But when we the overall cost is added, it is giving the right assignment. Actually, you can do the experiment. It would be nice.
Okay.
Correct, correct. The minimum distance between them. Yeah, correct. Sure. Okay. So I think these are the three things that we want to discuss as a part of DI. And open to any further Q&As, me and Nikhil would definitely like to address them. Or we can proceed to the case presentation. So we also have some case study presentations for you. And so Nikhil, if you would like to come. So problems in there.
Okay. So we had actually conducted a hackathon, which was a part of which was conducted on Machine Hack, and it was a machine learning plus a data science problem that we had hosted there, and there were about 1,100 people who had registered and about 70-80 people who actually submitted the results, and we found about 5 people who had really good submissions. So we thought that we'll use this time to actually have them present to us their work. So there are we'll get started with Nikhil Kumar Mishra, who's worked on the problem statement. He'll explain us how did he go about the problem statement, what was his finding recommendations. And similarly, we have Amay and Tirthankar as well, who will follow by him.
Hello. Yeah, good morning, everyone. A very brief introduction about myself. I'm Nikhil Kumar Mishra, a final year computer science student studying at Pesit South Campus. I'll not waste much time and begin right away. I have more number of slides to cover than the number of minutes allotted to me. So yeah, and I'll be assuming that some of the people have already gone through the problem statement just because of the crunch of time. Yeah, so let's begin.
Yeah, so the problem statement basically asks whether a person will switch his drug or not based on medical transactional data. So there's a company called Armanic. So it had asked ZS to provide a solution, and ZS recommended a machine learning solution. So like we had two different kinds of problem in this. The first was about feature creation. Yeah. So 3 types of features needed to be created. First was recency, second was frequency, third was norm change. And these features were to be aggregated on 3 different types of columns, event name, plan type, and specialty. So I'll explain these 3 types of features. Firstly, recency. So recently is basically saying what is the latest time something happened. So yeah. So what was my approach in feature generation? When we have things that can be done independently, they can be done parallelly, right? Independent calculations can be performed parallelly. So my main approach was parallelism, and how can parallelism be approached like utilized in computers through multiprocessing. We had a restriction on the machine configuration that we were allowed to use. It was of 4 cores. So at max, we can do 4 things at once, right? Okay, so in recency calculation, we had to basically group on 3 different kinds of levels. First was on the event, event name. Instead of event name, we could have plan type or specialty. We had basically 3 different types of columns. And then we had to group on the target type. Target type was like whether the person actually switched his drug or not. And the third was the patient. So basically, we had a large amount of transactional data. So we had to convert it into 1 row for each patient to give some information about the patient and then tell whether the person will switch his drug or not. Let me tell you something more about this thing. Feature creation part was more about the speed and the memory utilization. Okay.
So like recency calculation, I was able to achieve through multiprocessing in around 25 to 30 seconds. Yeah. So see, we have four cores of CPU, but event name, plan type, and speciality, these are three different types of columns in which the features are to be aggregated on. So at max, we are utilizing only three CPU cores. The fourth core is sitting idle. And once we send these features to these three different cores, we can finally concatenate the results. In case of frequency and norm change, we had to calculate it over time intervals. So the time intervals range from, say, 1 month, 2 months, or say 30 days, 60s, 2 months, 90s, 3 months, up to 1080 days, that is 3 years. So instead of three things at once, can we do better? Because one core is still sitting idle, right? So here, in this approach, what I'm doing is, I'm splitting the time interval, I'm sending the time intervals into the cores. So say in the first run, time interval 30 goes to one core, 60 goes to another core, 90 goes to the third core, and 120 goes to the fourth core. Next time 150, 180, 210, and 240 go. So here, instead of three cores, we are utilizing four cores at once. So we are achieving better speed, but yeah, frequency and norm change were challenging features. So I guess frequency and norm change took me around total 18 to 19 minutes to calculate. And with multiprocessing, I was able to achieve like 20 minutes. You can also use other hacks, like instead of strings, if you convert the things to numbers, it will be much faster. It will require less amount of memory. Instead of inbuilt Python functions like length, you can use pandas functions such as size, which are optimized. Yeah, I'll go straight into model building now. So in model building, mostly I'll be talking about my features. Features are actually the difference makers. People know that we can use neural networks or we can use gradient boosting methods to achieve state-of-the-art results. So what's the difference between a person getting 75% accuracy and a person getting 95% accuracy? It's just the features. Okay. Yeah, I had one question to ask to the ZS team. Why were there so many duplicate values? Like, two rows were exactly identical in the sense that they were 50% of duplicate values, and the frequency and norm change values were calculated on these duplicate rows. So I actually did not understand this part. Yeah.
I can answer that.
Yeah.
The data that was given to you was a medical history of a patient.
Yeah, yeah.
He can have two lab tests on the same day.
And same payment and everything will be same.
Yeah, so in general, yeah. Everything is covered by insurance. So he has three lab tests done in the same day. So that affects, means that the patient is severe.
Okay, I got it.
Thank you.
Yeah. So my model evolution, firstly, I use deep features. Then recency features is highlighted because that was a kind of magic. It helped increase the score a lot. And then I moved to other time-related features. I had payment-based aggregations, time and money, recent behavior. I'll be talking about all. Yeah, so firstly, deep features. So what is deep features? Say, you have three different kind of features, say, such as patient payment or event name. So for each patient, you will have different kinds of events. So in deep features, what you'll do is you say count the number of unique events for each patient. But here, what the problem is that you are losing a lot of information. For example, you are not considering each event. Say, for example, event one could represent some different level of how a person will switch, whether a person will actually switch his drug or not. Or say, event two could represent some different aspect. But when we do deep level aggregations, I mean to say, like, just count the number of times an event occurred for a patient, or say just calculate the total payment a patient made, we are losing a lot of information. I created a lot of these features, but that led me to a maximum of 77 UC only, and at the beginning of the competition, I was actually struggling. I'll not be talking about recency features, it's already explained, but recency features was the one which easily got me to 85 UC, okay. Other time related features. So what's recency? Recency is basically the latest time something happened. So if you are taking into consideration the latest time, why not the earliest time something happened? So that's the oldest time. And the number of times, unique times a customer was involved in the event. I took this as a feature also. For example, if you see the graph here, in say event 439, there's actually 140 days of difference between the person who actually switched his drug and the person who did not switch his drug. So yeah, these 20 features are actually the top 20 features with the least number of non-null values. So from the graph itself, you can see that the oldest time is also conveying some kind of useful information for the model to see. Similarly, in case of number of unique features, say plan 6 was the difference between number of unique times patient considered plan 6 for target type 0 and 1 was actually 7. Yeah, payment based aggregations. In recency features, we are only considering time based aggregation. But what about patient? What about payment? Even payment is helping, should be helping the model some way, right? So I felt that this competition was a series of hints which we needed to capture along the way to get better scores, right? So payment based aggregations, what you can do? You can do the max payment, mean payment, and total payment for each event type. I'm not calculating on all the events at once. So for event 439, I'm calculating the max payment. For event 439, I'm calculating the mean payment. Similarly, for event 1, 2, 438, okay? And the total payment, yeah. So even the total payment features, you can see there's a lot of difference. Say for specialty spec one, there's a 407 units of difference between the patients who actually switched their drugs and who did not. And even for mean payment, there's a great difference of 13. Yeah, total payment and mean payment, the scale will differ. So you don't worry about one is 407, the other is 13, because mean and total payment, the scale will obviously differ. But you can see even 439 was actually a very helpful event. We could analyze it more to ask why is this event actually causing more people to switch or not, And even max payment was also helping. Yeah, you could see even in max payment, even 439 is at the top. Yeah, time and money is everything, right? Everyone agrees to it, right? So we were missing some relation between time and money. First kinds of features we were aggregating on time. Second kind of features we were aggregating on money. But could we find a relation between time and money? Some kind of interaction between them. That was the question we needed to ask. So what is money? Money is a continuous variable. And time was being aggregated on categorical variables, right? So how could a continuous variable be converted to a categorical variable? Simply discretize it. And once I have discretized the money into categories, I'll calculate the recency, oldest time, and number of unique times for the binned payment also. Yeah. And actually, the increasing the number of bins was helping to increase the score a lot. I actually used 25,000 bins. Most of these bins were not being used because most of the payments were not falling into these bins, but that helped increase the score a lot, yeah. Okay, another hint. What about the norm change features? We could actually use a lot of the features that ZS has already provided, but I realized it late in the competition, so I did not use it. So what did norm change tell? It told how the behavior of a patient could change over time. The patient 3 years ago, he was involving into some different kinds of events or some different kinds of specialty treatments, and now he's having some different kinds of thinking perspective or spending capability or whatever. So when we talk about ensembling or creating different kinds of model, what different kinds of model we can create? What I did was, instead of taking all 3 years of data, now I created some models with only previous 6 months of data. Why 6 months of data? When we have 3 years of data, you can try with previous 1 month of data, 2 month of data, 3, 4, 6, 12 months of data. You can experiment with it. Okay, yeah. So, yeah. Now, model choice and model issues. Light GVM is, I use both gradient boosting techniques only, light gradient boosting machine and extreme gradient boosting. So light GVM was actually much faster than XG boost, but the problem was light GVM is that it is not memory efficient. So in light GVM, I could only use about 600 features, but in XG boost, I trained all my models on Kaggle itself. So in XG boost, allowed training with a much larger set of features, 12,000 features in only 16 GB of memory, 12,000 features. And I guess the reason of this is most of the features were null values, because you don't expect a patient to be involved in all different kinds of events or all different kinds of specialties. So most of these features were null values. So maybe XGBoost had some kind of sparse representation for these null values. So like XGBoost was handling memory quite well. And like for 5 folds of training, XGBoost took me around 30 minutes. And for 10 folds of training, it took me around 1 hour. So that's acceptable, right? Yeah. I had 4 different kinds of models, 2 light GBM models, one for the complete data, one for only past 6 months, 2 XGBoost models, one for the complete data, one for only past 6 months, and yeah, 12K features, XGBoost handled it quite well, so I don't use it. Yeah. So what's the idea behind ensembling? See, two people with different levels of expertise, they can solve a problem much better than a person with than just a single person. For example, in this case only, you could think that one model is better at predicting persons who are not switching drugs, and the other model is better at predicting people who are switching drugs. Or one model could be better at predicting switching capability of people with high payment. One model could be better at predicting switching capability of patients with low payment. So why don't we take the help of all these models? So in my case, as I showed in the previous slide, I had 4 different models and one model with deep features. So I had 5 different levels of expertise which I could use to increase my score. Yeah. So my models and leaderboard AUCs, you see the black one, the XGBoost with complete data, that alone gave me 88.16 AUC on the leaderboard. So that was my best model. And the rest, I did not actually remember the AUC. So I wrote 0.xxxx. So like, yeah. Light GBM was obviously performing much better, but it could not handle more features, so I had to resort to using XGBoost, and this was my final model. This Light GBM deep features, which initially gave me 77 AUC, I was using their predictions as a meta feature to Light GBM with all data, and Light GBM with 180 days of data, and XGBoost all days data, and 180 days data, finally to an ensembling classifier, which gives me the predictions. Thank you. Yeah.
Very good work done. One question. So what is the story? Like, what is the time-money relation you found which was indicating the switch?
Could you be a little more clear?
What is the relation in of time, money, and the switch? Like, how if could we predict the switching by time and money? If we are predicting,
no,
then
what I was talking about is like we had created 2 different sets of features. One in which we aggregated on the base of time, and one which we aggregated on the base of money.
Sure.
So why don't we have an interaction of time and money? So like, I'll not be able to tell you how exactly time and money both actually affected the model, but we can say that time and money together can have a much better capabilities than aggregating on time features alone and aggregating on money features alone. So like, we could think of it something like the person's spending capability changed over time. Like, 3 years back, he was not as rich as he is now. So you could think of it like this. And the rest, we'll let the model figure out what's the interaction between time and money.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you. Any more questions?
So you mentioned that you gave XGBoost all the 12,000 features.
Yeah, yeah.
Was there a better way of handling those 12,000 features? Can you reduce it in a way?
Yeah, yeah. Instead of 12,000 features, we could only use, top 500 features with least non-null values, right? Or we could actually find out the difference between the target 0 and 1, sort it on the basis of that, and select say top 400 or top 500 features.
Okay. And why? And one of your model in the end said that you looked at only 180 days.
Yeah, yeah.
Was there any specific reason?
No,
why
no,
not
no.
360 or?
No, I told you could experiment with that. And actually, I guess if you add more models like say 90 days only, or say 1 year of data, it will actually help increase your score score more, I guess. That was some random guess, like let's see the data for only 180 days and add it to the ensemble.
Okay.
Yeah. Your total number of features? 12,000 features in XGBoost.
No, and the rows, like total number of rows. Total number of rows was around 38,000. I don't remember.
Doesn't that create a problem where you have more?
Like okay, you mean dimensionality? Yeah, but I guess gradient boosting works fine with it. Yeah.
That's the other way of dimensionality where you have more features.
More number of features than the number of rows. I understand, but I guess gradient boosting handles it quite well.
Okay.
Yeah, I was having problems with neural networks with those same number of features, like 12,000 features. So neural networks was having quite difficulty. So I guess neural networks was stuck at around 77 or 78 AUC.
You didn't use any regularization so that something like L1 regularization or something so that it reduces the features.
Yeah, I used regularization for that. In XGBoost, my regularization values were actually quite high. Like lambda L1 regularization had values at 5.1, at 5, because like L1 regularization actually helps in automatic feature selection, right? So I had these values high because high values actually helped me in faster training times also, and out of 12,000 features I could automatically have like a good feature selection also, because like all these 12,000 features at once, it would create a lot of confusion and noise in the model, right?
So like I see your light GBA model, it has 600 features and the score is 86%. Then I see XGBoost model which has 12,000 features and the score is 88%. So out of that delta that you're adding 11.4K features, right? So do you think, like, what were the important features out of that 11.4K? Like, is there any feature? So out of the 11.4K, did you find that, okay, splitting was happening on a particular feature out of those 11.4K, or like, were they even important? Because
you could plot the feature importances and see, like when I plotted the feature importances, I did not include them in the slide. So even 439 and even 449 were the most important. So I guess the maximum split was happening in these two features only. Like there were more features, like the speciality spec one was also important. You could plot the feature importances and actually see like top 200, top 300 features. Like, but this was a competition. I was more like involved with the UOC, so I was trying every bit to increase my score more. But if you talk about, if you want to work with less features, say 500 or 600, it will still give you above 87, I guess.
Okay, because like it. So since you are like pivoting up the data on time, like you are creating certain event features, it might happen that a lot of these features are correlated.
Yeah.
Although in tree-based models, that correlation wouldn't matter. But say if the first one is event 400,
yeah.
The second might be out of those 600 itself. So
yeah. We had something called as norm change. So we could actually say calculate the statistics for the patient for the previous 2 years and 6 months and the recent 6 months, and calculate the difference in payment, say calculate the difference in mean payment or some kind of statistics and plot some graphs or something to see actually how the behavior changed. And instead of 6 months, you could do the same thing for 3 months, 2 months, 1 month and 6 months, and from the graph itself you could like actually guess which previous years, which recent behavior was actually helping you more. Any more questions? Thank you. I'll pass the mic to Ame.
Hello. Oh no, I'll use this.
Okay.
Hello. Can you hear me? Yeah. So hi everybody, I am Ameya More. I currently work as an associate for Think Analytics. And now I will be presenting my approach for the drug switch prediction problem. So first of all, problem statement. So the problem statement given to us was that Armanic is a pharmaceutical company who are releasing a new drug in the RA domain, and they wanted help in identifying patients who would switch from the current medication regime. So a little bit about domain knowledge. So RA stands for rheumatoid arthritis, which is an autoimmune disease that causes joint and damage across your body. So in the past few years, doctors and medical practitioners are using a treat-to-target treatment philosophy for RA patients. So treat-to-target includes three things. First is setting specific targets to assess remission or low disease rate. Secondly is trying to setting up monthly monitoring to assess if the treatment is working or not. And third and most importantly is switching your medication regime promptly if no progress is made. So the third point is where data science comes into picture. If you are able to identify patients whose current medication is not giving satisfactory results, there's a high chance that patient would switch in near future. So the data that we have provided was 3 years long, which had a transactional history for each patient. The transactional history included events like treatments, procedures, diagnosis. Also, specialties of the physicians who had administered these events. The insurance plans used to pay for these events and the payment made. So the data included around 16,000 patients, 500 event types, 200 specialties, and 6 insurance plans. Out of this 200 patients had switched and 14,000 had not switched. So you can see there was an imbalance in the outcome class. Over the period of these 3 years, on an average, a patient went through 60 different medical events, which were administered by physicians of 9 different specialties, and used 3 different insurance plans for payment. Those statistics were for all the patients. Now, comparing patients that had switched and had not switched, you can see that numbers for average events, average specialties, average plans are quite similar. Only difference you can see is in the patient in the payment that was made, and the times payment was made by the patient. Similarities could be seen in the most common events that happened to a patient. Now, feature engineering. Now, there were 3 features that we were asked to create by the ZS team. First was recency. Recency indicates the most recent event, or when the event happened most recently to a patient. There was frequency. Frequency was the count of event happening in a certain time frame, and norm change. Norm change indicated whether frequency of an event increased or decreased in certain time periods compared to previous time. Out of these, recency features were the ones which I used for my model creation. Frequency features I could have included, but did greatly increase the dimensionality of the data set. And most of these features had mostly compromised of null values. So now the approach that I used for frequency creation was that I did a group by on patient ID and event name, and aggregated using the min function, which gave me the value for minimum event time for each event. Now the second data set was in long format. I had to convert into a wide format. So that I used the unstack method. So using the pandas inbuilt functionalities, I was able to reduce a lot of computational time rather than doing it iteratively. Now for frequency features, what I did was I binned the event time so that I had a new column bucketed time. So basically, it was able to group events which happened in a particular time frame, like 1 month, 2 months, 3 months. Now, using the bucketed time, I concatenated it with event name. This step was only done so that I could match the nomenclature that was mentioned by the ZS team. Now, doing a group by on patient ID and event time, and aggregating by count, I got the exact frequency for a particular event happening in 1 month, or the second last month, or third last month. This is not entirely correct, as the actual requirement was that we were supposed to calculate frequency for the last 1 or last 2 months, but this approach gives you frequency of an event in the last month, second last month, and third last month. For calculating frequency over a period of time, what one can do is use the pandas expanding sum function. By grouping by on patient ID and event ID and doing an expanding sum, you can calculate the frequency of previous rows. Another thing, so I was not able to generate the norm change features and within the memory restrictions that were mentioned. So another thing that we had to do was fitness calculation. Fitness calculation told us how important a certain feature was. So this was the formula that was used for fitness calculation. Now, fitness calculation was a tricky part because we had around, I had around 20,000 different features. Now, iteratively going through all these individual columns would have taken a lot of time. So, I made use of the describe function of pandas. So, describe grouping by an outcome flag gave me two different rows. One for the outcomes with class 0 and one for outcomes with class 1. Now, describe function gave me different statistics like mean, standard deviation, and etc. Now, this data set was again in wide format. To convert into a long format, I did unstack on level 0, and I did stack on level 0, which converted the event columns into rows, and then unstacking outcome flag converted the outcome rows into columns. Now, after this, it was simple to do an apply for the fitness calculation function, and I got the fitness values. Some additional features that were created me were aggregated patient payments, basically the mean, max, average, and sum of payments made by a patient for a particular event and for a particular specialty. Another feature was, instead of using the frequency features for each individual event, I used the frequency for one event, the entire frequency of one event for a particular patient. Another feature was payment patient aggregated over, basically this aggregation was each the payment made by each patient over the 3 periods of time. Another thing was calculating the total number of events that happened to a particular patient. So now modeling. So I had used three different approaches. First was an XGBoost, then an ensemble of XGBoost and LightGBM. And the final model that gave me the highest score was a bagged light LGBM. So talking about the final model, the trick that did for me was using a correct cross-validation strategy. So basically, as I said, that there was an imbalance in the training data set of around 85 to 15%. So it was critical to train our models according to that imbalance. So using the stratified K-fold, I was able to divide the trained sets into 5 different folds. Each fold had a similar proportion of the outcome classes. Now, the model that I trained was a bagged model of 5 different models. So what I did was, for each fold of stratified K-fold, I trained one model for each iteration. The final predictions were an average of the 5 different predictions that were made. So the reason behind using bagging was that it reduced variance in my leaderboard score. So these were the feature importances. As you can see, recency features are one of the best features. Also, event time, which are the frequency, overall frequency features, helped in, or these were the most features that were used for most of the splits in light GBM. Now, for predicting hard classes, the submissions that we made for the AUC was probabilities. Now, we also had to make a submission of hard classes whether the patient would switch or not. For this, I used a greedy approach where out of the 5 patients, I used the threshold which gave the maximum AUC. That threshold was then used for converting probabilities into classes. So that's it. Thank you. Any question?
So in the model that you mentioned, right? So did you give all the 20,000 features you created, or?
No, I only used the recency features, which were around 700, and the additional features that I had created were around 3,000. So the maximum count was 4,000 features.
Okay.
Good afternoon, everyone. So I am Tirthankar. I am currently working in the Boeing Research Technology. So I am working mostly on the aviation and the health management of aircraft. Previously, I have worked in the HSBC. So I am having more than 5 years' experience. And I have no knowledge regarding this health. So I just thought, okay, let me try. And, you know, I am competing with the guy, you know, he's a final year student. Yeah, it's so nice to meet you, man. And so in the weekend, I do this, and I really find it stimulating, you know, participating in the hackathon. And so, and as you understand, I have worked in the BFSI, and currently I'm working in the aviation industry. I don't believe in the reputation, and specifically in front of those who knows already the problem. So I take use of, and the advantage of this, as I am the third speaker, you already know what is the problem statement, right? You know everything. So let me, can I go to the next slide? Can I go to the next slide then? Next slide. It's not working. It's not working. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Sorry for the technical glitch. It happens. You know already in the airport. You come to the airport and you see the flight is delayed because of a different technical glitch, and it happens everywhere. So the business objective is to identify the patient population, right? Who are most likely to switch in the RA market. That is a business objective. So I have kept it very simple. And I am not much believer of the, you know, ensemble model, because I always believe that is a kind of the overfitting problem you get, and you really need to spend a much more time to deal with the ensemble model. So I have used only the light GBM. Okay, I have used a single model, though it's a ensemble of the different boosting technique. So, and the kind of the key insights, I like to say that in the final model, I have used the 7,000 features. So out of that, we can see it is mostly dominated by the frequency factor features, because those are the number of features is very high, and then it is followed by the number of norm change and the recency factor. Okay, I have also believed in the CV, that is a stratified K-fold cross validation. So here I have used a 30-fold cross validation in the light GBM model. And already you got the point from the last two presentations that recency factor is the most important factor compared to the frequency and the norm change. And here you can see the top three from the three different category, that is one from specialty, event, and the norm change, what are the most important features. And that's my leaderboard result, okay? Okay, so let me give you the brief that what is the different step I followed when I actually tackled this problem. So there is a two block, I would say. One is a code block, another one is a data block. So we get that test data and train data. So first step, it was basically the feature extraction. So features, which was mentioned by the ZS in the hackathon. So I focused on that because I don't have any domain knowledge. So I tried to keep it on the expert opinion. So I did the feature generation from that. And the total features generated was around 40K. Okay. And 40K, and I use my normal laptop, which has 16 GB RAM, and it has not very great configuration, I would say. So what I did in the step two, that is a feature selection. So my final model was light GBM. So I used the light GBM itself for the feature selection. Okay, so I found out the list of important features. I pass it to the trained and test data. I got the train data for the model input and the test data for the prediction. Okay. So finally, I have found out I have used only 7,000 features. So there is a feature selection step I did. And in the step three, we build the LGV model, and finally I did the prediction. Okay, so that's the way. That's a very common process we usually follow in any model building, right? Feature generation, feature selection, and the model building. Right. Now let's come to a deep dive. What I did. Because there are certain things has been attached to the hackathon, right? Already I have mentioned there is a thing is that time complexity. So when I was finding out that we have to create the 40,000 features, because it was a transaction data we are given. Okay, so what I did, I actually trained and tested, I appended, I found out the all data, and these are the different labels I have to create: recency, frequency, and norm change. And under each cases there is an event type, plan type, and the specialty. So, as you know, there is a constraint of we have to use the four codes, right? So here what I used a multiprocess, joblib, and the delay. Those three functions we have been used so that we can tackle with the multiprocessing. And here I also given the option of the norm codes, where there's a flexible one that you can customize. Whether you want to put 4, 6, 3, 8, whatever you want to do, you do. But the thing is that I did it only for the frequency and the norm change. I did not for the recency one, because when I tested the time complexity or the time taken by generating the features, I found that normal pandas and the apply function was really working better compared to using the multiprocessing or the joblib. So I kept, because in case of the frequency and the norm change, as you can see in the range, we had to do it for the 36 times because we had the data of the 3 years. So loop needs to be done for the 36 times for the frequency, and for the norm change it needs to be done for the 18 times, because so 1.5 years we need to do for that. So we splitted that one and finally created the features. And instead of doing the things serially, if we do the things very parallelly, it actually reduced the times by 8 times, I would say. So that was a kind of the impact we can understand when you do the work parallel. So there is a next step, there is a step two. So that's the feature selection step. So here you can see there are three mostly important features. We can see the numbers for the different category, the frequency, recency, and the norm change. And so before just putting them into the live GVM, I just did the two pre-processing. That is, the first is basically the removing the degenerate variables. That means which has a standard deviation is a zero. And the second thing is basically the missing value imputation with a very high number. Okay, and the left hand side we can see there is a kind of what are the different hyper parameter I have used. I did not do much tuning because it's just a feature selection step. It's not the model building step, I would say. So we can just put the more or less tried and tested numbers there, and you can find out the features. And if we look at the top 10 features, we already can see in the top, very top, recency is actually a very predominating, and most all our features are from the recency, right? So that's the one. Then I tried to thought, okay, let me deep dive in the 7K features. Okay, what are the features that we are getting? Recency, frequency, and the norm change. So we can see the 370 numbers for the recency, for the frequency is around 5K, and for norm change is around 1.5K. So when we say the importance of the live GVM, right? So let me deep dive that why, what do you mean by the importance, right? Because XGBoost understand importance of the features in a different way. CADBoost understand the things in a different way. Live GVM understand the things in a different way. So if we just focus on the live GVM, as I use this one, so there's a two ways we can find out the feature importance. First one, basically the gain one, that how much gain we are getting when you are using that particular variable. Second thing, there's a split-wise. The split-wise reason is that how many times a variable has been used in the whole model. Okay, so there are 10,000 nodes are there. How many times the particular features has been used to do the splitting? So that actually explains the importance of the variable in that particular model. So if you can see that, 370 variables recency is there. So it has been used for 21% of time, whereas 5,000 frequency has been used for the 68% of time. So if we just go to see the average, so we can see the impact of the recency feature is quite high. So that's the kind of the importance, and I pretty believe that everyone has explained that pretty good. So that's the step I had. Now let me come to the third step. So it's a straightforward step. I have selected the 7,000 variable. I got the train data and the test data, and I did the stratified k-fold sampling, and there is a 30. I did that because I believe in the higher number, size matters. And we have created the different model from that,
And finally, I did the prediction on the test data set and I did the average of that. Okay? And there is a different hyperparameters, not the, all the hyperparameters I have written. The, these are the hyperparameters I found when I did the tuning, like, you know, learning rate you change from 0.05 to 0.01, how it is impacting, how your early stopping criteria is impacting, how the feature fraction is impacting. So I found that those features are really important. So that's why I have highlighted those things. And finally, when I did that, I got the highlight one. And finally, it did the prediction output. So that was a thing from my side for today. Any questions?
Yeah, one question to you. Why did you impute the null values with very high numbers? Isn't it dangerous? Will the model not find a split based on those high numbers? For example, if you say 5,000 values are null values and out of that, say 4,900 belong to class 1 and 100 belong to class 2, then the model will actually try to find a split using the imputed of those null values. If you're using light GVM can already handle the null values well. So why are you imputing it with a high number? Isn't it dangerous? The model will try to learn something which it shouldn't.
Yeah, surely. It's a nice point actually. So the high number, it has been imputed because so that I just want to treat it separately. I want to give that importance because sometimes missing value has also information. Like
no missing so values, right. Information might be noise. It might be noise.
It's noise. But I have found that initially, when you do that, you just put the not null value. You use that in a model. You see how it is working. Sometimes you put imputation. You see how the its performance. So when you see the imputation actually is giving the better performance. So I just thought, okay, let's go with that way. So that was the kind of the approach I took.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you, ma'am.
Hey, this is Abhishek here. Will your selection of like light GVM change if I say my data set is 16 million instead of 16,000?
It may change. But the thing is that light GVM has the, I would say, it's a lighter, it's a faster, it's a less memory consumption because we know that how light GVM works because we know in behind the algo, it split the leaf-wise, whereas in case of the XGBoost, we know it split the level-wise, right? So that's why here tree is complex, but memory consumption is better compared to the other boosting. So I request that, you know, you can try it. Though I have never tried the 16 million. That's my honest feedback.
So the number that was there for, like, for the CV, so like 30.
Yeah, that's also the result of some experimentation.
You started with, say, 5, which is the standard, and then...
Yes, exactly. I started with the 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. And I found that it's really, you know...
So is there any reason, like, with increasing those, like, different... Basically, you are giving different data each time you are training 30 models. So is there any reason that you feel that increasing the number of models might have, you know, like, it might have just increased your... accuracy overall, but it doesn't mean anything. So was there, like, how did you validate that increasing the number was actually increasing the model performance?
Oh yeah, so the thing is that I had a trained data set and the test data set. So when I did that, I just tried out that the difference is lesser or not.
Okay.
So that's how I actually checked, okay, whether things are actually improving or not.
So
that's
you're not able to improve the model further 30. So like,
I did not try, man. It was really taking a huge time. I mean, 30-fold certified is a huge.
Sure,
that's okay. Thank you. Thank you.